right, amen. Good to see you this morning. Happy Mother's Day to you. We're glad that we can celebrate Mother's Day with mothers, and we're glad that you're here this morning. I want to thank Miss Janie, first of all, for allowing us to have her mother's old furniture out in the foyer. It's a blessing. Janie told Karen that I believe these things look real nice in the foyer, and we wanted to make it more welcoming, and so we appreciate Janie doing that, and she was exactly right. I was a little skeptical when I picked up the stuff, and I said, I don't know, and then when I got it in here, I said, wow, that works out perfect, and so praise the Lord. Appreciate Karen and Hannah in their endeavors to fix it up and make it look nice, and we appreciate that. And then Lynn's sister, Tammy in my mind, but I was going to call her Melissa because Tammy McPherson. And so, anyway, Tammy, hey, your mind not going to work like mine. That's okay. It's all right. It definitely doesn't. And so, anyway, but your mind works a way that I was going to say I might not like, but I'm not going to say that either. I like your mind. And but anyway, amen. It's good to be here. And I'm telling you, that little walk outside has made me already start sweating. So I'm going to turn on my little fan here, and it's going to be all right. Again, glad to see you. Look forward to God speaking to our hearts. It's not going to be a typical Mother's Day message, but actually, as I thought about it more, and I'll say that to you during the message, it really is a Mother's Day message. And we're still going to be looking at the Sermon on the Mount. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for who you are. Thank you, Father, for your great mercy, your great grace, your great forgiveness, your great love. And Father, we know that all of us, again, if we're honest, we fail in recognizing how great thou art. And Father, just in gathering understanding of your mercy and how you work in our hearts and lives, oftentimes, in spite of us, that's not what we desire. We shouldn't desire that anyway. We want you, again, to get glory and praise out of our lives, and that we're just following you and obeying you, trusting you, that you're going to work out whatever the details are in our lives as we go forward each day. Help us, God, to be reminded of that, that you're in control of all things, and that we're willing, have a willing heart to just surrender to that. Thank you again for mothers. Father, thank you for the day that you've given us today to celebrate that. Father, we know that Jesus should have the central focus of all things, but you also tell us to give honor where honor's due. And so we thank you for mothers. We thank you, God, because you made mothers. And we pray that we would honor our mothers today. Lord, whether they be gone on to glory or whatever might have taken place, or if our mothers are living, we just pray, God, that you'd help us to bring glory, praise, and honor to you. Father, we love you and praise you. Bless the message, the songs that we sing, everything that we do and say in the service. We pray we get we'll be pleasing unto thee. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, Brother Randy.
Let's take our hymn books, please, and turn to page 793, For the Beauty of the Earth. Let's stand and sing all five verses, please, page 793. Thank you.
great song. What a great song. All right, Brother Richie, pray for us, please, sir, if you would.
Heavenly Father, we just lift your name up in adoration and praise for who you are and all the great things that you've done and the things you're going to do in the future, Lord. And we thank you for that eternal life. We thank you for that home in heaven.
Yes.
That we'll be able to enjoy because you're there and you be the central focus. And we'll be able to praise and lift up your name for all eternity, for all the things that your marvelous grace and mercy that you've extended to us. And Lord, we thank you for the privilege to be in your house today. We thank you for Mother's Day, Lord. And think about my own mom and a wonderful mom, loving mom, and I'm so thankful for that, Lord. Just bless the moms here today, Lord, in a special way, and be with them throughout the entire day. And Lord, we ask you just like speak to our hearts once again. And thank you for the message you've given our pastor. Help us to deliver that message, Lord. And we thank you once again for your great love. And we love you, Lord. And all these things we ask in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Had a good time going up, Karen and I and Sue, to see my mom and dad and then her mother. And delivered some different Mother's Day gifts that Karen and Sue had put together. And but just had a real special moment with my mom and called Pastor Baker this afternoon, hopefully, or maybe tomorrow. We were just sitting there talking, and my mom, of course, she can't put everything together in her mind as she's thinking of different things. And we just started talking about, I can't even remember why we got on the conversation with Pastor Baker. And she just had this look, and she looked at me, and this is what she said. I'm going to share this, and I know it'll be a blessing to him. It's a blessing to me. And she said, we like him, don't we? That's what she said. She said, we like him, don't we? I mean, just with a smile and heartfelt. You see, folks, you might lose all kinds of things. You might lose your mind. You just never know what might happen in your life. But God's touch upon your life and people that touched your lives, will be there in your heart. So it was just a moment of expression. And, of course, you weren't there, so you can't really, quote, unquote, feel it in the emotions of it. But just a blessing, and praise God for Mom and what God is doing there in her heart and her life and how he's used what happened to her with her brain aneurysm. To be a blessing. All right, our teacher of the week is Daryl Gaines. You appreciate him. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Appreciate Daryl and all that he does. And thank God for him. And continue to pray for him. Jeff Abernathy at UNC Charlotte is our, actually, they are not our missionary of the month. Is that? Did you tell me that that was?
That's what we had last
week. Yeah. Okay, yes, my fault on that. I didn't get it to Jesse. It's actually going to be Ron Smith. He's going to be our missionaries of the month. And again, I forgot to let him know that. So let's pray for Ron, and we'll contact them and see how everything's going. And if we can help him in any way, Richard Burrs, our NC Senator, certainly want to lift him up. And then the NC Highway Patrol, certainly they have a lot on them. We want to lift them up to the Lord also. And don't forget choir practice May the 16th and the 23rd, and looking forward to that, and hopefully get that going during homecoming. And of course, homecoming will be, anybody already know the date of that? June the 6th, Karen and I's anniversary, so it'll be anniversary and homecoming, and so again, looking forward to that. All right, amen.
Let's take our hymn books once again, please, and turn to page 560, More About Jesus. Let's stand and sing all four verses, please, page 560.
More of his love who died.
induced coma in Boise, Idaho. So do pray for him, lift him up. Ms. Joy sent me a text last night. She just said that he needs a touch of God, and so we wish, certainly want to pray for him. Ms. Joy's still here, and I believe Autumn's gone out there to be with him. So I just pray. I know that separation is mighty difficult, and so just pray God would work that out there for them, if you would. I remembered now, Randy, what it was this morning that I forgot. I had a circle right here, and in our Sunday school class, oh, the microphone's gone out. Excuse me, folks, microphone's gone out, so we're going to make a change of pace here. Maybe we can cut and paste this out, and nobody will ever know. If not, it doesn't matter. All right, it was Earl. Wait a minute. Got me all tripped up here. Sorry, but this is great for Mother's Day, I think. We're going to try that. But anyway, that's... Can't do anything different for me because I'm going to mess it up. But anyway, Earl had his pacemaker put in. It went well, and so he's doing good. And he's going to be, he's got another appointment this coming Wednesday. They only fly out of the bush Wednesdays and Saturdays. And it's about 30 miles from the nearest hospital. And so, as I mentioned to you, Wednesday, he's the pacemaker, I didn't tell you that. Had a pacemaker put in, he's doing well, and he's got another appointment this coming Wednesday, and then he's flying back to the place there on Saturday, this coming Saturday, and then he's planning on leaving from there and coming back to Texas probably the 1st of June instead of October, like he planned. The cardiologist felt like this is something that he needed to do, and of course, they're believing and trusting God that that's what God wants them to do. Then Charlie Leventhal, she got out of the hospital. They got her, sent her home on some antibiotics, and so telling them what they need to do as far as care for her, and so continue to pray there for her, if you would. And of course, pray for all those on our prayer list that don't know the Savior. Especially pray for Herb Hanley, whose cancer came back, and so he's not saved. Also pray for Pearl Canterbury. She's having to wear a heart monitor. So lift her up, dear sweet lady. Certainly want to pray for her also. All right, Brother Sam, you pray for us, please, sir, if you would.
Our Heavenly Father, we have sung about the fact that we need to know more. We need to know more about your word, more about the Lord's coming, mm-hmm. more about many things, but most of all, we need to know more about your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Help us, God. Help us.
We thank thee for him. We thank thee for every truth that we know of him, and mm-hmm. we do long to know more of the truths of his sacrifice on our behalf and his work for us, not only on the cross, but at thy right hand as our intercessor and our advocate. We thank thee this morning for him, and we just pray that our lives might become more and more like him. Mm-hmm. Father, we pray that as we've gone through this list of people and various needs, we're thankful that you know all the details, and you have a plan for every person on this prayer list. We're thankful that you have a plan for every person who is in this world. And one of those plans is that they would come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Mm-hmm. Our Father, we pray that we may never stand in the way of your plans.
God help us.
But that we might have a burden for them. And mm-hmm. we pray, our Father, that your will and your timing might just be seen in many people's lives. We think how often that we have unspoken requests as well.
Sure.
They may not be known to us, but they're known to Thee.
Yes.
We pray our God and our Father that You might meet those needs as well according to Your will and Your time.
Mm-hmm.
Father, again, we would pray for the message this morning.
Help us, God.
We don't want to just gather facts from
sure.
the Sermon on the Mount.
Amen.
We want them to be truths that become mm-hmm. reality in our lives. Many of these things are difficult for us to take in.
Sure.
Partly because we don't want to admit to being murderers and adulterers and being like the scribes and the Pharisees and making vows that we won't keep and the many lessons that we've been hearing, and we just need Your Spirit to make them realities in our lives, that our righteousness might be real, that it might be righteousness that follows the godly line. There's been a godly line all through Scripture,
mm-hmm.
and there's been a line that has been like the way of Cain,
mm-hmm.
who just would not take your offer of salvation, your offer of forgiveness,
mm-hmm.
because he just wanted to go his own way.
Oh God.
Our Father, there's so many people and so many times in our own lives that we want to go our own way.
Oh God.
We just pray that You would give us the help to depend upon the Holy Spirit to make us what we should be, to break us where we need to be broken, humble us where we need to be humble. We ask these things in the precious name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Help us all. Amen. Matthew chapter 5. Once again, we're going to do something here that hopefully you will be able to pick out. Last week, we read a passage of Scripture and what we were dealing with in Matthew 5, and we said there was something there that if it was taken out of context, it could say something that it does not say. Do you remember what that was? Anybody remember what that was? We were dealing with oaths.
Swear not at all.
Swear not at all. Okay, and so we talked about that last week and hope you understood that if you take that out of its context, you'd say, hey, don't ever make any vows or oaths or anything. And certainly Jesus was not saying that. And we know that from Scripture and bringing Scripture together and understanding that we will make oaths, but we need to make sure these oaths that we make, that we are having a willing heart to do what we're saying we're going to do. And that's so important. So this morning, we're actually going to read another passage of Scripture that we're dealing with. Remember, we're dealing with six things that Jesus said. Ye have heard it has been said, but I say unto you. We said all along, what's important about that? Well, what's important is what Jesus says and not what somebody else says. And also, we're dealing with the letter of the law in the spirit of the law. Also, throughout, we're dealing with verse number 20, that except our righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, again, we shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of heaven. So, again, it's all the way through the Sermon on the Mount that there's a comparison between what we really would call works righteousness or man's righteousness or what man thinks or what real righteousness is Christ's righteousness. That only He can do. And so you come to the Sermon on the Mount. You come to a lot of things in the Bible. Just in sin prayed. You say, well, that's impossible. And there's a lot of things that are impossible in this life for us to be able to achieve what God desires. Now, you think about motherhood. You think about being a mother. It's really, without God, it's really impossible to be a mother. A mother has so many task and so many things that, again, that are tied to motherhood and bringing up children. Now, of course, fathers are important too, but both of them are important, and God has given both of them different roles. And so we're going to read the passage of Scripture in verses 38 through 42 as we deal again with a subject that the scribes and the Pharisees took way out of context. And then I'm going to read three other passages. Well, I'm just going to read two, and you can take my word on the other passage of Scripture. And I want you to figure out who this was written to, okay? And I'm going to do that in just a minute, and I'll explain to you that in just a moment. But first of all, I'm going to read these verses, and I want you to pick out the phrase in here that could totally be taken out of context. And by the way, it is so out of context today in our own society. It's amazing how, listen folks, over 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 years, you know, things have not changed very much. And what you need to realize, what I need to realize is, God is still the same, and so is man. And God needs man. I mean, man needs God. I had Ian Thomas's thought in my mind where he says it takes God to be a man. And it takes Christ to be a Christian. There's no other way. And really, that's what the Sermon on the Mount's all about. Is God showing us what real men and women are and what real Christians are. Real followers of God. Kingdom of God people. And so when I read this passage of Scripture, you tell me what would be something that might be taken out of context if you just took it at face value. The Bible says, you have heard, verse 38, you have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you that you resist not evil. But whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if a man will sue thee at the law, and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not thou away. Now, I'm recognizing some things as I read this passage of Scripture. There's actually a couple of them in here that could be taken out of context. Now, who can tell me at least one of them that I might be looking for? Yes, Miss Sherry?
Resist not evil.
That's one I was looking for. But as I was reading at the end of this, you could also give to him that borroweth and not give, you know. That's also could be taken out of context. But that's not the one I was looking for. I was looking for resist not evil. Resist not evil. Now, folks, listen. Did you realize people have built doctrine around this? There is actually, now, I talked to them about this last night. This guy, his name is, I want to call him Toy Story, but that's not his name. His name is Toy Story, I think. So anyway, Toy Story comes in my mind. And he actually said that because of this particular passage of Scripture, there should be no police. Now, is that what the passage of Scripture is teaching? Absolutely not. He said there should be no military. Is that what it's teaching? No. He says, but wait a minute. It says resist not evil. Now, how are we going to refute this guy? Context. And also, who's he talking to? He's not talking to the government. He's not talking to nations. Really, he's not even talking to churches. He's talking to individuals. He's talking to people that he's already said so many things about in the Beatitudes. So really, the truth of the matter is, this is about the Christian. Now, folks, listen, you cannot expect a worldly government to follow the Sermon on the Mount. It's impossible. We live in a lawless society. And where there's a lawless society, you know what you need? You need laws. But folks, listen. I hope that this has come across to you clear. Now, our flesh needs laws. Okay, we still have that old Adamic nature. But our new man, our spirit man, we're free from the law. Why? Because we have a new wanter within us. Right? We want to please God. We went through some of these things that in Romans chapter 7, Paul talks about this battle that's within, wanting to do right, but having the flesh that pulls you towards doing wrong. And all of these things go hand in hand. And so really the truth of the matter is, it's impossible to do what God requires you to do without God, without Christ. And so what he's saying here is going to be the same thing. You see, the Pharisees and the scribes, they just said, hey, well, you're okay if you do this. Okay? Now, we want to talk about, just like we've done in some of the other sections, what exactly does the Bible say when it says an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth? What is the actual scripture talking about? Now, here's where I want you to pick up on something of whose responsibility. I'm giving you a lot of details here, so I'm hoping you'll get it, okay? I'm not like one of those teachers that want to make it so hard for you can't even figure it out. You ever had one of those? I've had plenty of those in college. It's not fun. But here, I want you to figure out, according to the law, we're going to read two passages of Scripture. It's actually found in three passages of Scripture, but we're going to just read two. Okay? So first of all, we're going to turn over to Exodus chapter 21, and we're going to see what this eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, it actually said. Okay? Exodus chapter 21, and then we'll turn over to Deuteronomy chapter 19, but it's also found in, if you want to write it down, in Leviticus chapter 24. So Exodus chapter 21, look with me there, and let's see what the Bible says. And again, I want you to pick up on something, okay, of responsibility, okay? Now, look at me, excuse me, at verse number 20. Let me make sure I am reading. Yes, okay. Verse number 20. And if a man, chapter 21, verse 20. If a man smite his servant or his maid with a rod, and he die under his hand, he shall surely be punished. Notwithstanding, if he continue a day or two, he shall not be punished, for he is his money. If men strive and hurt a woman with child, so that her fruit depart from her, and yet no mischief follow, he shall be surely punished, according as the woman's husband will lay upon him, and he shall pay as the judges determine. If any mischief follow, then thou shalt give life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot. And you'll go on and on and on in that as far as this under the law. Okay? So, we read that there. Now, let's go over to Deuteronomy chapter 19. Deuteronomy chapter 19. And you'll find, again, same thing. This is given under the law. Okay? Now, we're going to start this reading, all right? And, excuse me. Verse number 15. One witness shall not rise up against one witness shall not rise up against a man for any iniquity or any sin. If any sin that he sinneth at the mouth of two witnesses or the mouth of three witnesses shall the matter be established. If a false witness rise up against any man to testify against him that which is wrong, then both men between whom the contrary is shall stand before the Lord, before the priest and the judges, which shall be in those days, and the judges shall make diligent inquisition. And behold, if the witness be a false witness, hath testified falsely against his brother, then shall ye do unto him as he had thought to have done unto his brother. So shalt thou put the evil from among you, and from those which remain shall hear and fear, and shall henceforth commit no more any such evil among you. And then an eye shall not pity, but a life shall go for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot. So two passages of scripture. If you read the Leviticus passage of scripture in 24, you'll find the same thing. But there's something interesting that the Pharisees and the scribes, as usual, okay, have left out. Do you know what it might be? The judges. That's right, the judges. Did you see in this passage of scripture, and you'll see it also in the Leviticus passage of scripture, this was not up to the individual. This was up to the judges. Now you say, Pastor, why is that important? It's still important today. Amen. Let me tell you why. Now, people don't like this, folks, and it doesn't matter what people like. Do you understand that? Now, we're dealing with resist not evil, right? This is the passage of scripture when God knew we'd be here. He knew the times we were living in. But I have found there is so much against police and all of these things today. And almost every, now I don't know about all the cases, but all the popular cases, all the ones you read about in the media, a lot of things would have been solved if an individual would have just responded to the authority that was over them. We might not see people dead in the things that have happened. Now the problem with that is people don't like to hear that, but they need to hear that. This has been going on since the days of Moses. This is why God put this in the Bible and gave it to people. What? To deter crime. To stop the criminal. And to not have retaliation and excess individually. So if there's a problem, if you get pulled over by a... Now, I know there's corrupt police officers, but most of them are not. But our society that we live in today has made it that way. And we need to understand this. When somebody pulls you over, just do what they say to do, regardless.
Amen.
Right? Just listen. If they do wrong, it doesn't matter if you say, well, our system's corrupt and all these other... I understand that too. But it's never given as an individual responsibility for you to take the law into your own hands. This is exactly what the scribes and the Pharisees were doing. They totally skipped the judges and the priests and taking it to the proper authorities. They said, you can decide yourself what needs to take place. God never said that in the eye for an eye and tooth for tooth. Never. That was never be the attitude. It was never, first of all, for a believer's attitude. If somebody punches your eye, how about say your nose, your eye out, right? Your response was never to be, well, I want to take his eye out. Now, again, that's our response oftentimes. And I'm not saying that's not in the flesh. But really, the truth of the matter is, it goes beyond that because human flesh is wicked. Somebody takes your eye out, you want to kill him. And that's what was taking place in their day. And so these laws had to be put into place so people wouldn't over retaliate. That they would, it would be an equal measure. Now I'm amazed how God brings things back to your mind of your own life and your own history. I'll tell you, so what are we saying here? This was given so people wouldn't go excess. And basically this, that the punishment would fit the crime. Right? Amen? That's really what he's saying here. And he's saying that this should go to the proper channels, the proper authorities. Right? That's the original. We want to look at the original law, correct? Now, I had something in my life, a tragic event. It might not be a tragic event. Lynn Bias died of a cocaine overdose in 1986. My goodness, it still stirs me today. You know, this was my idol. This was somebody that I loved, and I really thought I knew this guy. I mean, I just, why? Because I spent a lot of time watching him and seeing him and all these different things, and he died of a cocaine overdose. And guess what happened? During that time, you know, people did not know a lot about cocaine, the drug at the time, and all of a sudden, you know what happened in our government and our officials? They went in excess. They started putting people in prison for drugs for 40 and 50 years. And murderers were getting out in 20. Can I ask you a question? Is that in excess? Mm-hmm. There was people that were, they were, you know, they were making a crime of drugs. Now, is drug bad? Of course it is. Right? But that punishment of 40 years in prison because you sold cocaine and a guy's, you know, getting out for manslaughter or something else in 15, right? I'm hoping you're with me, right? That's in excess. See, these laws were given, and so people wouldn't go too far. They'd be under some kind of, really, and that's what we need to see, that under some kind of restraint. And you remember that Jesus has already said in this sermon, folks, that he says that think not that I've come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. Amen. And then his desire is to fulfill that same law in our own hearts. Right? Listen to me, folks. You cannot imitate or follow the law just as well as you cannot imitate the Lord. You need the Lord, amen, himself to be able to have real righteousness. He's the only one that can do all these things that are required. I hope we at least get that out as far as the Sermon on the Mount is concerned. And so, this has absolutely nothing to do with not having military, not having a police, not having these things. We need laws. We need these things. This was written to the Christian man. Really, the follower of God. That's who it's written to. And so, the only way that's ever going to happen is if God comes into his life and changes him. So we can't use this passage of Scripture when it comes, and we cannot expect a corrupt government and a corrupt society to have no laws. Have you seen what's happened in some of these cities like Portland and Minneapolis and these other places where people just, hey, go crazy over stuff? Well, that's coming even worse, folks. But we're not dealing with those folks. We're dealing with ourselves. And so in the context of the Scripture, we need to see what Jesus is saying to us as Christians. How are we to respond to these things? And so really what he's saying there, when he say, but I say to you, ye resist not evil, he's talking to you and I in our attitude towards other people when these kind of things happen to us. Now, obviously, folks, if I was, we're not living in that day, but how many of you, you know, I don't want you to raise your hand, but how many of you ever been backhanded? You ever been backhanded? Richard already shaking his head. And I guarantee you, what was it from your mama? I didn't think so, Rich. Now, very few people have been backhanded, but Richie has, and he knows what that feels like. Okay? And I'm sure Richie was out of line. That's why Daddy did it. And we're not advocating that, all right? But most people have never, this has never happened to you. Bam! You know, backhanded, right? And so, most people that's never happened to. Now, most people have never lived in the day, well, nobody has, where you had this inner coat and outer coat that you wore, right? Okay, that's never really happened to you either, has it? As far as going to the court of law. But we can use this. How many of you have ever been to the court of law, been sued for something? Not very many people in here, right? And then how many of you, in the Roman day, you were required to walk a mile to take, you know, it didn't matter. If a Roman came up and you're right there as a Jew, and you had to pick up that pack. And you had to take it a mile. It was required, period. Okay, now most of us have then not followed in that. But the truth of the matter here is, folks, listen, the Christian goes beyond his duty. Goes beyond his duty. Now, folks, we live in a day today. I'm just trying to be honest with you, okay? We can't even get people to clean a church. We live in a day today, we're so busy that we're doing our own thing, that we have most times it's the same people doing the responsibilities. Now, some people can't clean the church. I understand that. Now, folks, listen to me. If you don't want to clean the church, don't clean the church. Okay? But I do think this is simple. It's simple stuff. It really is. It's our duty and responsibility to do certain things as a church body. It shouldn't be up to one or two or three people. We all should have a desire to do what God would have us to do. But we live. Reason why I said that is not so you'll go sign up and clean the church. The reason I said that is because we can't even get people to do the simple things today, much less go the extra mile. We're not even doing our duty. So how in the world are we going to go discipline ourselves to go the extra mile? We're not. We must first see our responsibility. And so Jesus here, the whole idea here in verse 38 through 42 is our attitude towards others and our attitude towards ourselves and what happens to us in our lives, and that we're not to retaliate or take revenge, but yet we're to have an attitude of forgiveness and mercy. Now, he's already come. Now, this doesn't mean, folks, listen. He is not saying that as a citizen, you have certain rights and different things. And listen, you look in the Bible, you remember, now we've talked about this, I believe, I can't even remember if it was 15 years ago or so when we preached this. You remember when the priest, or I can't remember if it was the priest, that backhanded Jesus, slapped him. Y'all remember that in the scriptures? Wasn't the priest, but it was somebody there. It might have been that Roman soldier or somebody. And Jesus asked him there. He said, why you do that? Now, that wasn't for himself. It was because, listen, you didn't just slap somebody for no reason unless they've done something wrong. And he slapped Jesus, and Jesus had done nothing wrong. But it wasn't for himself. It was for others. Paul, the same thing. Remember when Paul was in prison and they found out that he was a Roman and they said, hey, man, let's get him out of here real quickly. You know, we found out he's a Roman. And Paul said, you tell him to come in here. Why did he do that? Because, again, as a citizen of Rome, he was protecting other citizens of Rome. So listen to me, folks. You have to separate your Christianity and your citizenship. You say, how do I do that? Biblically. You say, how would I do that? I don't know. Ask God. You are a Christian citizen, but it doesn't mean that, hey, these laws and these things, we need to uphold the law. We need to have a desire for other people not to be hurt. He's never saying here that you don't protect your family. Okay? He's not saying anything about, you know, let somebody beat you up. It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with your attitude when you're done wrong. I'm always amazed at people, how they can have forgiveness, and you can't do this without God, forgiveness for people that have killed a family member. Do you realize how tough that would be if somebody killed one of your family members? Especially one of your children? I mean, you know as well as I know, in your heart, you'd have a desire for revenge, right? But what do we have to do with that? We can't go out and kill them. We have to give that over to God and put it in the judge's hand, even if they do wrong and there's corruptness. But ultimately, again, in our heart's heart, we have to learn how to forgive them and have mercy upon them. It's not that we say, listen, folks, would you listen to me? If somebody kills your family member, having mercy upon them and forgiveness in your heart does not mean that you want them not to get punished for the crime. No, they deserve punishment for the crime. The law has to be fulfilled in that. Now, ultimately, what you want is them to get saved by the grace of God, amen? And then, if they truly get born again, get saved, you would like them to be free out of society if they could, if God would allow that and give them mercy. That's always up to God and what God does when he pardons and gives mercy. But ultimately, you and I have to have the right attitude when it comes to people doing us wrong. And so the first thing that he says here, but I say to you that if you... that ye resist not evil. He said, but whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. Now here, he deals with greater and lesser through all of these things. Okay? And so, when somebody backhands you, or if they smack you in the face, you know, you turn the other cheek to them. Now again, this is not what you're doing, okay? When you turn the other cheek to them, you're saying, why don't you smack me on the other side? That's you're not saying, you're not telling him to do that. But by turning your other cheek, just turning that way, you know, you're allowing him to say, hey, you know, I took that blow from you, I'll take another. I'll be willing. And really the truth of the matter in all of this whole thing he's talking about here is having a willing heart to do what God would have you to do when it comes when you've been treated wrongly. You see, folks, listen, this is not going to come out of your thoughts. It's not going to come out of your emotions. It's going to come out of your will. Choosing. But here, what has to change? Our emotions and our thoughts. You see, it just works that way, right? If you have revenge in your heart, God's got to get that out, doesn't he? If you're a vengeful person, you say, hey, nobody's going to do that to me, you're going to have a bad time in life, because a lot of people are going to do some bad things in your life to you. And so really, it's our attitude of choosing, again, choosing what? Choosing Christ and allowing him to work in our hearts and lives. And there's several passages of Scripture that I want to get to in the New Testament that goes right along with this that God wants us to have this morning. And so, again, it's your attitude. It's turning the other way. And then he said, if any man will sue thee at thy law and take away thy coat, your outer garment, he said, let him have thy cloak also. This would not be required. The cloak, again, as you study this out, it's something that, hey, you had to give back to a man. This is something you would never do. But he says, hey, give it up. And really, folks, ultimately what this is talking about, now again, he's not talking about giving up your rights as a citizen of the United States of America. Folks, listen, we want to be citizens, trust me, of the United States of America. Now, it's heading in the wrong direction for sure, right? But hey, we're glad that we have certain rights and certain things. But when it comes to this walking with God and different things, with that being aside, we have learned again that whatever might happen to us, hey, we're willing to give up even more. Go beyond again. And what is this doing? It's heaping coals of fire upon a man's head. When a man, we've said this before, when a man is your enemy, okay, and man, say you got a neighbor, and man, they're always on your nerves, okay? You despise them in your heart. You know what you ought to do? I've said this to you before, right? Bake them a cake. Knock on their door. Why don't you go today? That's not loud enough. Hello. What are you doing here? I just came over to see what's your favorite pie. All right. Well, what about your cake? What do you want to live for? I just thought I might bake you one. Or make you one. Or buy you one. Now, folks, listen. I'm not saying that they might not continue on. But what's your attitude to be? Why did you really go over there? Hopefully it'd be out of a heart of love. Right? Because, listen, again, the Bible says love covereth a multitude of sins. It doesn't matter what somebody else does to us. What we have to recognize is how we're to respond to that. How are we going to do this? Now, most people are not going to, you know, when you take the pie over there, I'd hope this wouldn't happen, that they take the pie and put it in your face. That'd be tough, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? How would you respond to that? Well, I hope we respond the way Jesus tells us to respond. Would it be hard? Of course it would. It'd be impossible for you to do it. And hopefully in just a minute, you're going to see some passage of Scripture to help you understand that. That's only God can do this. And so then he comes down and he says, in verse number 41, he says, "And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain." So again, what we're seeing, go beyond your duty. Right? Right? You with me? Anybody can, you know, do the duty. But it's thinking God-like. Thinking what might make somebody else happy or joyous or you know, just doing something again that yes, you this might be required, but go beyond that. And so here you can see the Jew there and boy, he's already can't stand this being under Roman government. You remember when Jesus came, the disciples and all these people were excited. Yeah, man, Jesus is here, the Messiah. We're not going to be under Roman rule anymore. He's going to rule and reign. And Jesus said, "I'm going to die." What? My dream, my vision, what I thought just blew up in my face. Peter said, no way, Lord. He had just said, "Thou art Christ." And then three verses later, he said, no, I'm not letting that happen to you. You're not going to die. You're our king. You come to set the kingdom up, right? Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan. For thou savorest not the things of God, but the things of man." Aren't we so guilty? Right? Trying to take matters in our own hands. And that's really what he's talking about, truthfully. And really he's talking about having a willing heart, having a desire to not just do our duty. Man, don't mothers, again, more so than fathers. I can tell you that now. Some fathers do. But mothers go beyond their reach sometimes. They just, again, you know, mothers, again, oftentimes, again, more so than fathers, they just want to see their children happy. Now, they may do wrong stuff, folks, to do that. We've all done it, haven't we? But I tell you, there's just something about mothers, they just want to see their children happy. I'll tell you, my mom, it don't matter. Listen, folks, I go up there just about every week. And Dad says when he goes to the diner, he said, "You want your special? You want your normal? 3 hot dogs and a fry." And of course, he's got plenty of Klondike bars in the fridge. I gave Sue my Klondike bar this week. And I'm really lacking, folks. And man, I'm stuffed to the gills. But that mama ain't happy. And she's like, "You didn't eat nothing. You want my fries? Want my onion rings?" Gee, why? She wants me to be fed. She wants me to be satisfied. She wants to go the extra, right? Right? I've seen Karen time and time again for my children and for myself cook meals, things that we enjoy, things that we like, you know, these different things that we all should desire, right? Now, folks, listen, that's great when it comes to children, but it ought to be greater when it comes to God. That's what I'm trying to say. We're all of us. We so focus on man. We need to focus on God and living godly and for His glory. Amen? So God help us. And then He comes, He says, "Give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn him not away." You see, again, it goes back to the scribes and Pharisees, and really they lived a life that everybody owed them. That's the way they lived. You know, we owe nobody anything. Everybody owes us. Bow down to me. Now, folks, listen. We've already said this from the get-go. We all have a Pharisee within us. He's called the flesh. We want people to bow down to us. He wants the attention. But we've got to say no to that. We've got to say, "God, you got to help us with this. You're the only way. It's the only way that we can be what we need to be." So now let's turn to some New Testament passages of Scripture real quickly, because I'm sure time is slipping away. First of all, we're going to go to Philippians 2, and then we're going to go over to Romans, okay, chapter 12 and chapter 13. But go to Philippians chapter 2 first. Philippians 2, Philippians chapter 2, and then we'll go to Romans. And notice again what the Apostle Paul, again, he's dealing with this church at Philippi. And folks, listen, this is, again, a book of Christ. It's a book of joy, but it's also a book of, again, dissension among people. You know, listen, when you have people, you have problems, okay? You're going to have difficulties. You're going to have skirmishes and strives and different things that are going on. And guess what it does? It robs you of your joy. It robs you of what God wants in your life. And so Paul here is talking about, early on in chapter 2, of Christ and his humility and all these things. And by the way, listen, if you're going to die to self, you're going to have humility. You're going to have to be willing again to bow to God and his will and what he wants in his way. And you got to get out of the way and let him work in your heart and life. And so he comes down to verse number 12. And of course, this is a favorite passage of scripture for those of work salvation like the Jehovah's Witnesses. They love, I remember being over here, I think, or one of the parsonages that I lived in, and they love to quote this verse, man, when it comes to works salvation. Listen to it. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as my present only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Now that's, again, contextually, okay, no, we're not contextually. Just pull that scripture away out of everything else, right? And you would think that you need to work out your own salvation, right? That you do the work, correct? And that's what, listen, can you, please, almost every single false religion is built on a text that is taken out of context. So people, hey, the scriptures say that, work out your own salvation. Yes, yes. But we know the whole Bible teaches that it's not work salvation. It's grace. It's grace. But here, again, read verse 13. This is exactly what I said to this person that came to me. I said, hey, wait a minute. You know what verse 13 says, don't you? Well, no, they didn't know what verse 13 said because it's excluded from their teaching. Look what it says. It said, for it is God. Y'all got that? Which worketh in you. You see that? Work out your own salvation. But it's God working in you. So what are we to be? Cooperative. That's our responsibility. With who? With God. You see, you can't do this, folks. Now, folks, listen. If you could do it, then guess what? You could boast about it. And by the way, many people do boast about it. Like the Pharisee and the publican, remember we talked about that? And how he says, man, I'm not like this publican over here. I tithe every day, I do all this, I do all that. Well, yeah. Anybody can fulfill duties. But we're talking about devotion. We're talking about going beyond. And what we're really talking about is dying to you and your selfish nature and allowing God to work in your heart and life. He said, it is God which worketh in you both to do what? To will and to do of his good pleasure. So, ultimately, it's God working in you and me. He's doing the work through us, his will, okay, in his working. It's God doing it in us. And you and I's responsibility is to yield ourselves to him and his will and his working. You see, folks, we all have lived a life, more than likely, of trying to do things in the flesh, doing it our own way, and say, why can I not succeed? The reason why we don't succeed, because we're never going to succeed in our own flesh and trying to do it ourselves. It's not going to work. You cannot. Now, I just picked this book up off my shelf. We cleaned up, Karen and I did, and the office there, the study in there, and at home, and getting rid of books. And Thomas A. Kempis has written a great book called The Imitation of Christ. But really, he probably should have made it a different title. He really did. Because you cannot imitate Christ. Now, the book is wonderful, and it's not really saying that. It's just a different term. But anyway, you cannot imitate Christ. You can't do it. He's the only one that can imitate. He doesn't imitate. He is himself. And really the truth of the matter is, what you and I need to do in our lives is just let Christ be himself in us. Amen? Are you with me? This is the only way that we're going to turn the other cheek. This is the only way that we're going to give more when somebody sues us, right? It's the only way that we're going to give to people that, hey, borrow from us. No, I want this. This is mine. You know when this starts? When we're little kids, right? Some little kid comes and we got to tell him. Now, I almost said Johnny, but I didn't. Okay? We have to say, Bobby, let Johnny play with that. But it's mine! Are y'all with me? Why should I let them borrow anything? It's mine. It might get broken. It might. Right? But is that what God says? No, we ought to have an attitude that if we got something that somebody else needs and they come and ask, we have to have the attitude to say, yeah, it might get broken, but it doesn't matter. God will take care of that. He's blessed me with this, and now I can bless somebody else and let them use it. Now, folks, listen, I'm the world's worst. I can't stand borrowing stuff anymore because every time I borrow something, it breaks. I'm like, man, you know what I say in my heart? I got to fix this. That's terrible. Now, just like me, I know you got flesh. I know you do. Why? Because we're all the same. And we need God. And so God's got to do it. Now, real quickly, a couple passages in Romans really gives us the gist of this thing of retaliation, what's in our heart, and letting God take care of things, and that you and I, when it comes to this thing of resisting evil, okay? He's talking to Christians in this passage of Scripture. Now, turn with me over to Romans chapter 12 at the latter end, okay? And notice what he says here. And again, I want you to get this in context because this is all, the only way this is going to happen in our hearts and lives is if we love God and we love others. It's the only way. Listen, the Sermon on the Mount is a love message. We have to have the love of Christ in our hearts to be able to carry out what his desires are. Romans 12, verse 9. I'm going to read the whole thing again. And then you can go back to it and see Paul is saying the same thing that Jesus was saying. He says here, let love be without dissimulation. That means without hypocrisy. Abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love. In honor, preferring one another. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of the saints, given to hospitality. Bless them. Oh, you see, everything sounds good. You know, hey, Paul, man, that's wonderful. That's great. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. What? Well, you see what he said already. Let love be without dissimulation, without hypocrisy. You know he's going to go on in the Sermon on the Mount and say, if you love them that love you, right? He's already said that. What good are you? He says, rejoice with them that rejoice, weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend, okay? Humility. Bring yourself down to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. So, I know a lot of you in here are glad for an escape clause, aren't you? You say, well, it's not possible. Now, I think most people that make this statement, they've never gone that far with it. Okay? I just believe that in my own heart. Now, there are some people that you may never be able to live with. It's just facts. I'm sorry. And he gives us an escape clause there. If that's the case, okay? But more than likely, it's not. Okay? We We need to do everything we can to live peacefully with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself. Okay? Don't have this desire. Hey, if somebody knocks your eye out, that you want to knock his eye out. If he knocks your tooth out, you want to knock his tooth out. Okay? He says, why? But rather give place to wrath. Okay? For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hungry, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in doing so, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. And this is the kicker, folks, of the chapter. Be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. Amen. Right? Shouldn't that be, no matter what somebody does to it. I know, folks, listen, things not happen over and over and over again in our lives? Are y'all with me? That it's a continual, my goodness, when am I going to get through this? Right? Now, that's not the attitude that we should have. Okay? God's got to change our attitude in our lives, and we got to realize the Bible says that Jesus, the joy that was set before him at the cross, he went all the way through. He's worthy. But now, folks, listen, can I tell you something? Everything we do rightly for God and his glory, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Amen. That's right. There's no doubt about that. But that doesn't even matter. What really matters is he's worthy of real righteousness. He gave his life. And we got to ask ourselves, we got to say, God, you must help us with that. So be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. And then he goes straight in to chapter 13. He says this here. Look under verse number 10. Now you can look at the whole passage of Scripture. Okay? But he says, love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Okay? Early on in the chapter, he talks about giving ourselves over again. And he says, in that knowing that the time, that now is the high time to awake out of our sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chamberness and wantonness, not in strife and envying. But, again, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Again, the only way, as we go back to Matthew chapter 5, dealing with what the scribes and Pharisees says, hey, it's your right, it's your individual right to take matters in your own hands, because God says an eye for an eye and a tooth for tooth. So you can do that individually. It was never given to the individual. It was given to the judges to decide what would be the proper punishment. When you look all through the law in Exodus and Leviticus and Deuteronomy, God placed this judgment into the hands of the judges. And so you had to go before the judge, and they had to decide proper punishment. Why? Because people taking things in their own hands, trouble happens. It's not good. You and I are not above the law, and neither is anybody else. And we don't need to take the law into our own hands and decide what we're going to do. We need to allow God to take care of. Ultimately, in the end, he will take care of everything. And so, the passage of Scripture, when he's talking about resisting evil, he's talking about you and I overcoming evil with good. Choosing in our heart's heart, although we cannot do this within ourselves, we can't have the right attitude on our own. We need Christ and Christ alone. We need to put on him. We need to let him to both will and to do this great work in our heart and life and changing us, no matter how much somebody else does wrong to us. We must choose, again, right? Have a willing attitude and a willing heart. Now, again, you say, Pastor, how far does that go? Only God knows. There are times where you have to say, I can't do that any longer. There just is. Live peaceably with all men, if at all possible. So I believe God, just the same thing with 70 times 7 of forgiveness. Now, you're always to forgive, okay? That's our attitude. That's our heart attitude. But you're not always to give to somebody. Now, Oswald Chambers was a different bird. He said he gave to anybody to ask, even if he had his last dime. If he didn't have anything, he gave it to him. That's what he said. Now, I don't believe the Bible teaches that, but maybe God, hey, obviously God told him that's what he needed to do. But here's what he said about that. He said, not a lot of people came and asked me for stuff. He said, God protected me in that. So, to each his own, right? You got to let God guide you and direct you. But ultimately, it's the attitude of the heart. It's having a willingness, a desire. Now, we all have that if we're saved. But sometimes that fades away in our hearts and lives. We need to ask God daily to help us with this. So when we're done wrong, it's not for the state, it's not for the government, it's not for nations. He's not writing that to them. He's writing that to Christians. What's our attitude to be towards people that do us wrong? Well, he just told us. We're to have an attitude of mercy. We're to have an attitude of grace and forgiveness. And I tell you, every last one of us in here has done God wrong. And yet he showed us mercy and grace. And he expects us to do the same. But not in our own power, in our own flesh, but in his power. Let's stand to our feet. Brother Randy's going to come. Miss Melanie, pray God has spoken to your heart through this passage of Scripture. Certainly, we don't need to take things in our own hands. And because somebody else does us wrong, we choose to do wrong ourselves. Pray God would change our hearts. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for who you are. Thank you for this passage of Scripture. Father, we know that, again, this is Mother's Day. And really, the truth of the matter is, mothers, they don't get a lot of credit for a lot of things that they do and the sacrifices that they make in their lives for their husbands and their children. They're not really recognized. As we were reading that passage early on there, it says, give honor where honor is due. Tribute is due. And so, Father, we know that motherhood really oftentimes is a thankless job. We know ladies and women can get discouraged thinking that the things that they're doing, the things that they've given their lives for, they can even get focused on that. And we know that's not right, Father, but we know also there's a great battle that takes place. And help us as men and fathers and sons, and help us to be encouraging, Father, not just words, Father. Help us be with our lives. To go beyond, Father. This is what you've called us to do. Beyond. And we know if we're going to be do more than our duty, we'll have to be disciplined. But we also know that it's going to have to be devotion, Father. It's going to have to be love without dissimulation. Love without hypocrisy. God, help us with that. You know our struggles. Help us to put on charity. Help us to put on Christ, who is charity. Guide us and direct us in this invitation. Help us to respond the way you want us to. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hymn number 488, just as I am, you come, if God's spoken to your heart. this morning, certainly a message that's applicable for today, something we need to understand and get it all in one message, obviously, but we need God and His direction. Randy Smith, you close us in prayer, please, sir.
No, we thank you for this day, and thank you for the privilege we've had to be in your house on this, for the Lord's Day and on Mother's Day. And I thank you, Lord, for the mothers that are here, and Lord, for the mothers in our lives, Lord. I know my mom's passed on, Lord. I miss her every day, and I thank you for her and for her godly influence, and for my wife and the mother that she is. And I pray you'll just bless each of the mothers. I pray you'll help us, Lord, to meditate on the message that we've heard today, and Lord, help us. Lord, as we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, Lord, help us to realize, Lord, that it's not something we can do within ourselves, that we need you to help us to do what you've commanded us to do in that sermon. Just bless our time together as families this afternoon. Lord, keep us safe. Bring us back tonight without the loss of one. In your name we